honored and privileged to have been asked to give Dr. Satyapal a memorial lecture. And the theme that was chosen is indeed very important, very topical, very relevant today. It has a contemporaneity, echoes from partition, 70 years of Indian democracy. I will raise some questions and I will try and answer them in about 45 to 50 minutes time. I think the basic question is, what has been the journey of democracy in a partition-haunted society, India, after 1947, as our Vice Chancellor, sir, gave you a sense of, it was really haunted by the memory of partition. Not just that, it was also a society that had undergone 2 centuries of colonial rule, alien British rule. So in a society which had witnessed partition in 1947 and experienced 2 centuries of colonization, of economy, of culture, of mind, how did this society start travel on its journey of democracy, the 70 years? That is the story of the talk for today. I am a historian and I look at this question by going back in time. So I will go back, I will start my story, let us say, with the second half of the 19th century. It was roughly since the second half of the 19th century, modern period of our history, that our new Indian intelligentsia, rising middle class, the best minds of the times, they developed a yearning, a great craving for democracy and for nationalism. Both these ideas became extremely important, crucial. They almost became sacred ideas for the new intelligentsia. This was also the time, second half of the 19th century, when gradually a nation of Indian people was also growing. So at a time when a nation was gradually growing, that was the time when our leaders, our society, developed a kind of yearning, a desire, a craving, both for nationalism and also for democracy. And both these ideas, the idea of the nation, nationalism, and idea of democracy, they were kind of aligned with each other. They were seen in such a manner that it was felt that you had to do both. You cannot opt for one of the two. You cannot be undemocratic and nationalist, and you cannot be democratic without being a nationalist. You had to be both, democratic and nationalist. Nationalism was seen in the sense of a broad homogenization and consensus. So there would be a homogenization of people. People would come together from different cultures, different languages, different regions, and there would be some consensus amongst them about certain ideas. And this consensus obviously meant, if there is a consensus, there would obviously be a kind of a democracy. Now, this was not a natural growth. As far as the possibility of Indian nationalism was concerned, there were broadly 3 dominant imaginations of nationalism in India then. First was a British imagination, which was strange because the British writings of the second half of the 19th century, they completely ruled out the possibility of a nationhood for India and also democracy. They felt that a large traditional plural society like India can become neither a national society, nor can it become nationalist, nor can it become a democracy. Thanks. So this was one imagination, that there would be no Indian nation. There cannot be an Indian nation. As against that, there was a rival imagination from certain sections of the Indian intelligentsia in the early 20th century, which claimed that Indian people were a nation since the ancient times. So Lala Lajpat Rai wrote a book, very important book, where he declared that Indian people, India had been a nation for the last 3,000 years. So the word civilization and nation were kind of conflated. Nation was seen in civilizational terms. As against these 2 extreme positions, there was a mainstream imagination, which was that Indian people are in the process of becoming a nation. Indian people are a nation in making. It's a job in making. It's not that they cannot become a nation, but it's also not true that they have already become a nation and they always were a nation. They are in the process of becoming a nation. This was the mainstream imagination of Indian nationalism. And this imagination, mainstream imagination, had four broad templates. It was said that this Indian nation is territorial. That is to say, all those who occupy this territory, this landmass, are part of Indian nation. This Indian nation is civic. This Indian nation is plural. Plural in the sense that they, unlike Europe, they do not speak one language. Unlike European nations, they speak many languages, they have many cultures, they come from different regions, different clothes, but there is a kind of a nationhood. So plurality was of the essence of Indian nation, and non-coercive. That somehow people are not being forced to conform to certain standards. Indian nation or nationalism is broadly non-coercive. So these four ideas, territorial, civic, plural, and non-coercive, they became the templates of this dominant mainstream imagination of Indian nation. Colonial rulers had denied both of them. They had said, Indian people, India is not a nation, it is a geographical expression. India is not a community of like-minded people, it's only the name of a geography. India is only the name of Himalayas in the north and an ocean in the south and desert, etc. It's only a geography, not a nation. On democracy also, the British had said that Indian people are not fit for democracy. A community has to be prepared and suitably prepared for democracy. Indian people are not. They said Indian people are only fit for a benevolent despotism. That there should be a despotic rule, but of a good kind, benevolent despotism, like you have kind rulers and generous rulers. So Indian people are neither fit for nationhood nor fit for democracy. They are fit, they are a geographical expression, and they are fit for a benevolent despotism. But our leaders did not agree with this, and they kept making demands. And our leaders, since the 19th century, kept making demands on the British rulers to give us a representative government, to include Indians in the government, and so on. And they constantly made demands. And so our tryst with democracy, or India's democratic experiment, actually did not start in 1947. It had started earlier. Because of constant pressures being put on the British government was almost forced and compelled to make certain concessions and to create representative institutions. So it was unlike some other colonies of the world. India, in that sense, was better off. We got democracy, limited democracy, but we got some kind of a democracy in 1909. You would be interested in knowing that voting rights were given, but voting rights were given only to a few people, rich people, people with property, people with education. A total of 4,000 people had a right to vote in 1909. Gradually, it increased to 3% of the population in 10 years' time. And by 1947, when we became free, till then, about 14% of the population had a right to vote. There was no notion of any fundamental rights. Not a single British law or act or constitution that was made for India made any reference to fundamental rights. The first reference to fundamental rights that was made by two Indian leaders, Motilal Nehru and Tej Bahadur Sapru, who had prepared a draft of a constitution for India, in which they listed 19 fundamental rights, some of which were later incorporated in the Indian constitution. But all in all, the story of the initial decades of the 20th century was that it was indeed possible to combine the two ideas, idea of nationhood and the idea of democracy. And the two went together. Gandhian movement, Mahatma Gandhi's movement, was indeed based on mass participation. So Indian national movement was going like an outward growing spiral. The national movement was gradually reaching out to new groups, new areas, new communities. So the 1905 Swadeshi movement was confined only to cities and cities of Bengal and Punjab and Maharashtra. The next movement, which happened after Jallianwala, Punjab was very active. Villages, the movement reached out to villages. Then it reached to students. Then the next movement reached women, tribals. So gradually more and more sections kept becoming a part of the national movement. And as they became a part of the national movement, democratic possibilities and indeed national possibilities, they also increase. So both of them, people's participation, people's empowerment and a nationalization of society, all of them happened together and simultaneously as part of the national movement. The first major setback to this happy and growing union of democracy, conceptual unity of democracy and nationalism, the first major setback to this union happened in the late 1930s. So there is a kind of a twist in the tale at that point in time. What is the twist in the tale? An important Indian leader, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, he was then an old congressman, but now a leader of a separatist organization, All India Muslim League. He, since the late 1930s, started making very, very different claims on behalf of the Muslims of India. First claim, three claims he made, and they are interesting. First claim that he made was that the Westminster type of democracy, the British type of democracy, one man, one vote, choosing representatives, going to the parliament and so on, that Westminster type of democracy was unsuitable for India. India was not fit for that kind of a democracy. British had said 60 years ago that Indians were not fit for democracy. Jinnah said that this Westminster type of democracy was not fit, was unsuitable for India. The second claim that he made was that in India, India had its majority and minority. All societies have their majorities and minorities. But in India, majority and minority were not political, but religious. Political minorities, those who have greater support in politics, in democracy. But in India, he said, our minority majorities are not political, but religious. And therefore, they are somewhat fixed and stable. You cannot change your allegiance. In politics, people sometimes vote for Conservative Party and 5 years later they vote for the Labour Party and then someone else because they are political majority and minority. But he said in India, majorities are not political but religious. Therefore, somewhat fixed. It would not change easily. You can't change your allegiance so easily. And hence, the third thing that Jinnah said was that therefore, democracy would only mean a perpetual domination of the by the majority over the minority. And this would be fixed for all times to come. Majority, because it's a religious majority, will always dominate over the religious minority. And therefore, this democracy is not good for India. In other words, what he started saying, he had not said this earlier. In the 1930s, he started saying that in free India, once India becomes independent, in free India, 70% Hindus would perpetually rule over 25% of the Muslims. And this was the basis on which he started campaigning amongst the Muslims and he started trying to mobilize the Muslims. Now, this type of claim had not suddenly sprung up. It was a culmination of a certain type of politics, which we call communalism, that had begun since the early part of the 20th century, in which organizations like the Muslim League and organizations like the Hindu Mahasabha had suddenly started saying, they used to say very similar things. Their argument was that a man's economic, political, social life is determined by his or her religion. So it is the religion which decides your entire universe. So what should your politics be? Look at your religion. What should your economic life be? Look at religion. What should your relationships be? Look at religion. So they began to look at religion as a kind of a fixed sole determinant of your entire political and economic life. This politics gradually increased and culminated in the kind of claims which Muhammad Ali Jinnah started making. From here, from saying all that there'll be a rule of majority over minority, our majority minority are not political but religious and so on, and democracy is not suitable. From here, from this point onwards, Jinnah went on to make an even more novel claim and a claim which would completely shake and undermine the foundations of Indian nationalism. And that is when our idea of democracy and nationhood would come under strain. His claim now was, in 1940, it was put forward formally in the form of a resolution in Lahore. His claim was that Indian Muslims are not simply a religious minority needing protection, concessions, and safeguards. Minorities need concessions, safeguards, protection. But he said Indian Muslims are not a minority. They are a nation. They are not a religious, simply a religious community. They are a national community. As a national community, they are entitled to their own representative, separate, sovereign state. So Muslims in India should have their own separate representative sovereign state. Now, how can you have a separate sovereign state of the Muslims who are scattered all over the country in all the districts? There was not a single district in British India district which did not have a combination of Muslims and Hindus. So how are you going to then separate them and create a separate nation state of Muslims and a separate nation of state of Hindus? The whole project was fraught with very serious dangers. Now, this demand, this came to be known as two-nation theory, that there was no single Indian nation, but instead there were two nations in India. There was a Hindu nation and there was a Muslim nation, and both these nations should have their own separate states. You cannot have one state for these two nations because they are different nations. Now, this was an entirely different imagination of a nation, completely in opposition to the mainstream imagination that I spoke to you about. I had said that the mainstream Indian nationalism was territorial, that all those who live on this territory are one nation. This new imagination is not territorial, it is ethnic. It says, does not say that all those who live on a territory, it says all those who belong to a particular faith, particular religion, they are a nation. Mainstream Indian nationalism was civic. This rival imagination was ethnic. Mainstream Indian imagination was plural. It recognized and respected plurality, linguistic, religious, cultural, all kinds of pluralities. They said that all the Indians, no matter what culture they have, what language they have, what religion they have, they are all part of an Indian nation. The current new imagination was in which this plurality was not recognized. It existed. A Muslim in Punjab had nothing in common with a Muslim of Bengal and Madras, but this plurality was denied. At the time of 1941, which was the time of census, you would know that we have decennial census, then Muslim Muhammad Ali Jinnah made an appeal to all Muslims that when you go for the census, please enter your language as Urdu. Now, this was strange because Urdu was a language only of the Muslims of North India, not the Muslims of Bengal, not the Muslims of Maharashtra, not the Muslims of Madras Presidency. But an appeal was made. Why? Because the European understanding is, the European imagination is, that a nation should speak in one language. Just like the British people, just like the French people, just like the German people, they speak one language. Therefore, even this Muslim nation, even if it does not speak in one language, at least one language should be upheld as that language. So it was also a kind of a not, a, it was also de-recognizing a certain plurality which existed. Mainstream Indian nationalism, the imagination was non-coercive. I'll come to this point later. The new alternative imagination which Jinnah put forward and which leaders of Hindu Mahasabha had been putting forward, it was not all that non-coercive. So, the real challenge for the leaders of Indian nationalism was how to deal with this, what to do. Now, there is a rival imagination of a nation which does not go along with our established mainstream imagination of a nationhood. How to deal with it? If you recognize it, going by the principle of non-coercion, if you recognize that this is also a nation, then that would mean undercutting the very basis of one's own political existence. Then how can you emphasize, how can you propagate Indian nationalism if you recognize that there is a separate alternative nationalism? Muslim League claim had, in a sense, outstripped the British position on Indian nation. The British had only said that an Indian nation did not exist. The Muslim League in the 1940s actually said that an Indian nation could not exist. It was an impossibility. A multi-religious nation of Indian people is a mirage. It's an impossibility. It cannot really happen. Now, the challenge came in the year 1942, when the two ideas, nationalism and democracy, which had been happily going together, they came under strain. They came under stress. They came under tension. How? around 1942, this was the time of the World War, and there was a lot of pressure on England to settle the Indian question because the support of Indian people was needed for the war. America also put a pressure on Churchill, so they sent a leader, Cripps, to India, offering some kind of a concession in return for India's support for the war. Indian support for the war was considered as very necessary. 25 lakh Indians had enlisted in the army. That's much more than the size of the Indian army today. So you can imagine the kind of involvement that was required then. Now, when Cripps came to India and he settled, he came and offered a proposal. That proposal was such that it virtually conceded Pakistan. The proposal said that all those provinces which do not want to join an Indian Union after independence, they can, through a 60% majority, they can separate. Now, this created a challenge for the leaders of Indian nationalism. What should they do? Should you extend the democratic principle to this? Then that would completely undermine the very foundations of Indian nationalism. It was under these circumstances that a Congress resolution, which was drafted by Jawaharlal Nehru, it actually made its first concession to the idea of Pakistan. The resolution said that we are opposed to Cripps' proposal. We are opposed to all these provisions which say that provinces can secede. However, we cannot force any part of India to remain with India if that part of India does not want to be a part of India. So we cannot be coercive. We cannot coercively include any part of India into our India. So if someone wants to be away, then we have to recognize the right to separate. So Congress conceded the right to separate. Gandhi went further. Gandhi put it very differently. Gandhi said, I can think of no non-violent way of forcing a people to remain in a union if they as a consensus do not want it. He also used a very nice imagery. Gandhi, his language used to be very traditional. He said, we the Indian people are a joint family. We are a clan. As you happen in joint families, any member can seek a separation, but the family bonds still remain. Brothers fight and they separate, but that bond remains. So Gandhi said, any member can claim a separation from the larger family, but the bond should remain. In 1947-45, after Gandhi was in jail from 1942 to 44 because of Quit India movement, when he came out of jail in 1944, a lot of pressure was put on Gandhi to settle the question with Jinnah. So Gandhi and Jinnah decided to meet in Bombay at Jinnah's residence. They met every day for 2 weeks and also wrote letters. In that, Gandhi actually suggested a mechanism, a democratic mechanism, to settle the question. So Gandhi said all the districts of Punjab and Bengal, which have a mixed population of Hindus and Muslims, they should all do a plebiscite. And if with the majority, they decide to be part of India, then they should be a part of India. But if a majority, they want to be a part of Pakistan, let them be a part of Pakistan. So Gandhi put the entire Pakistan idea to a democratic test, except that the test will not happen at a provincial level. It will happen at a district level. This was a formula which had been made by one of the leaders, Rajgopalachari. You may have heard of him. That did not work. It was rejected. And from 1944 to 1947, there were a series of negotiations, conflicts, violence, communal rights, some of which our Vice Chancellor talked about. Finally, after the failure of all the negotiations, India was eventually partitioned. And not just India was partitioned, even the provinces of Punjab and Bengal, they were also partitioned. Independence and partition happened simultaneously. In a matter of 2 days. On 14th of August, India was partitioned. 15th of August, India became independent. This time, these 2 days were, in these two days, Indian nationalism won and lost at the same time. Victory, independence, it was its moment of great accomplishment. After two centuries of colonial rule, after a colonization, as I told you, after a colonization of economy, of culture, also of the mind, it was a new opportunity. So India becoming independent was a great opportunity. It was a moment of great accomplishment, but also in some ways it was the darkest hour of Indian nationalism because Indian national unity was compromised and India from one country, it was partitioned into two. Independent India instituted a full-fledged democracy, consciously so. There were many doubts. Many people said that a country with 14% literacy, yes, India's literacy rate in 1947 was 14%, and literacy for women was about 9%. That meant 1 out of 10 women was barely literate. So many Western commentators said that a country which is so poor, where literacy is so low, where life expectancy is 32 years, an average Indian lived only for 32 years in 1947. In such a situation, how can you have a full-fledged democracy? But our leaders, they were convinced. They said if the hungry, illiterate, ignorant people can fight in such a big anti-imperialist struggle, then they can also choose there. They can also participate in democracy. So independent India instituted full democracy, full-fledged democracy, which was mandated by its constitution. So it was written down in the constitution so that it does not change very rapidly. Whatever you put in your constitution, which is your stable rule book, then that's important. The Indian constitution, speaking on behalf of the people of India, all the people, let me just read its preamble. It's beautifully written. We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a, and the five words are, sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote them all, fraternity. And it just goes on. I think this was an important statement. It did not mean that we had become a secular democracy. It just meant that this was a dominant aspiration of Indian people. Constitution is also a statement not of realities, of what is it that we want in future. These were the aspirations of the people. So democracy was firmly instituted as an important political, social value for Indian society and for the people of India. Thus a new journey, thus a new democratic journey began. First general elections were held in 1952, largest anywhere in the world on the basis of adult franchise. Anyone more than the age of 21 years got a right to vote. So that was a great accomplishment which has to be recognized. But the realities of partition were bound to take their toll on the Indian Republic. Indian partition was a unique event. At one level, we can say that there is nothing unique about the partition. 20th century is a century of partitions. More partitions have happened in the 20th century than ever before, than any other century. If you look at the 20th century, then you would find Ireland, Cyprus, Palestine, that is to say Israel, Germany, Kuwait, Korea, Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia, USSR much later, among others. Large number of partitions have happened in the 20th century. India's partition is not the only one. India's partition, then Pakistan's partition in 1971. There is something about 20th century that large number of partitions have happened. What is it about the 20th century, a 20th century of great human accomplishments? What is it about the 20th century which has made it so partition prone, so prone to partitions? It's a difficult theme, it's a prolonged theme, but I can tell you two things, two factors come to my mind. First, of course, is retreating imperialism. Imperial rulers, when they retreat, they do not seem to bother very much about the territory, whether it's going to remain one or it's going to be partitioned. And also superpower rivalries. We've had our superpower rivalries, which are claiming territories. So one superpower claims one territory and the other one claims the other territory, and result is that you have a partition. Most of the partitions of the 20th century can be related to either retreating imperialism or to major superpower rivalry. But that is not the theme for discussion today. I would like to argue that in spite of the fact that in the 20th century so many partitions happened, but it can be argued that India's partition was really unique in some ways and very different from all the other partitions. It was unique in its tragedy. It was uniquely tragic. It was not a very happy consensual handshake, golden handshake kind of a partition. It was very tragic, very contested, very bloody, very violent. Something like 3 lakh people were killed in partition violence. Some latest figures put the estimates put the figure at 3 million, 30 lakhs. We do not know. 30 lakhs may be an exaggeration. But something like between 3 lakhs and 30 lakh people were killed in partition violence. And who were the killers? Not the professional killers. Quite often killers were people like you and I. People killed because they wanted to save their lives. So if 2 people came and one thought that the other person would kill him, then in anticipation he would kill the other person. So large number of killings were done by ordinary, decent, non-violent, peace-loving people like you and I, and they killed because they wanted to save their lives. That was the kind of situation that people were in, that hatred had reached such a point. So 3 lakh to 3 million people were killed. Over 70,000 women were abducted and raped and put in extremely humiliated, made to go through extremely humiliating experiences. They were displaced twice over because at some point there was a commission of abducted women between India and Pakistan, and they decided to exchange their abducted women. So when women came back to their home, because of the stigma about what had happened to them, they were not accepted back in the family. So they were displaced twice over. That's a real tragic story on which of late now some books are being written. 12 million people migrated. It's the largest human migration around a single event. And these 12 million from India to Pakistan, from Pakistan to India, they migrated, but their migration was not driven by opportunity. They did not migrate like you, some of you will migrate to America, searching for a better life. Opportunity-driven migration. This was not an opportunity-driven migration. It was a migration because they migrated because they wanted to save their lives. Quite often they left a life of decency, life of comfort, affluence, property. They left all that and they migrated because they had to migrate. Now, all these things, the number of people killed, women abducted, the number of forced migrations, they make India's partition a very unique event, different from all the other partitions of the 20th century. Now, why was this partition done? Muhammad Ali Jinnah had made 3 claims. The first claim he made was that we have a minority problem in India and that has to be solved. Therefore, partition. He had also said that there's a Muslim problem, that Muslims are a minority and they are prone to be persecuted by a minority, therefore partition. He had also said in 1942, some journalist had asked him that can there be conflict between the 2 countries? And Jinnah said no. Jinnah said that India and Pakistan, after partition, they would live like very happy neighbors. Because Pakistan will be a kind of a buffer state for India. Pakistan will protect India from onslaughts from the West. And therefore, India and Pakistan will live like happy neighbors. Now, obviously, nothing has been further from the truth. The minority partition did not solve the problem. It made the problem worse. It exacerbated the problem. The minority problem was entirely actually exacerbated. Both the new nation states, India and Pakistan, they were minority haunted. Partition, so both of them had their minorities and which had to be taken care of. Partition was particularly tragic for those Muslims who chose to stay behind in India. Not that it was great for those Muslims who actually went to Pakistan and settled. They had their own problems and stigma there. But those Muslims who remained here, their minority status increased. From a minority of 25%, they became a minority of 12%. And a minority that was stigma-ridden, minority that was without an elite, and constantly under pressure and constantly haunted. Third, India and Pakistan have also not lived like happy neighbors, as Jinnah may have anticipated. The 2 countries have gone to 4 wars with each other, 1947, 65, 71, and the Kargil War, 98. It is our unfortunate record in South Asia that after the Second World War, no 2 countries have gone to war with each other as many times as India and Pakistan have. then there is Kashmir. Kashmir is not a problem which goes back a long way. It's also a product of the partition. So in some ways, we are still living, coping with the legacy of partition. Partition is not something that happened in 1947. In a way, it continues to cast its spell on our lives, on our thinking, even today. It's a continuous issue in some ways. It affects the quality and nature of our democracy even today. Let me quote a very interesting statement from Mahatma Gandhi. He had made this statement at a prayer meeting before partition happened in July 1947. I will read it very slowly so that the effect of it begins to sink in. He's anticipating certain things. Contrary to whatever else people said, Gandhi said, "The Pakistanis will say that they must increase their armed forces to defend themselves against India. India will repeat the argument. The result will be war. Shall we spend our resources on the education of our children or on gunpowder and guns?" This was, if there was ever a prophetic statement, it is this. Let me read it out for you again. "The Pakistan will say that they must increase their armed forces to defend themselves against India. India will repeat the argument. The result will be war. Shall we spend our resources on the education of our children?" And by we, he did not mean just India. He also meant Pakistan, the people of Pakistan, the government of Pakistan. "Shall we spend our resources on the education of our children or on gunpowder and guns?" Last question for today, which is in some ways the topic. What has been the democratic trajectory of this partition haunted society? What has been the nature of democracy in India in the last 70 years? In a country which had been a colony for two centuries, in a country which was just haunted by partition, a serious event like the partition. Social scientists make a distinction between procedural and substantive democracy. So democracy can roughly broadly be divided into two kinds of democracy: procedural democracy, or the procedural component of democracy, and substantive democracy. What is the procedural democracy? Procedural democracy focuses on the prevalence of democratic institutions, regular elections, and so on. So superficially, all the democratic things should be happening. If we go by the procedural definition of democracy, then India has done indeed very well. We have had 15, in the last 70 years, we have had 15 elections at the center. 15 elections for the central government. And out of these 15, 8 times there has been a change in the government. 8 times the running, serving government, which has all the resources at its command, the army, the police, the bureaucracy, 8 out of those 15 times, the continuing government has lost the elections and the opposition has come into power. This transition from opposition to government and government to opposition has indeed very smooth, and we should take pride in this. The picture in the states, different states, has been even more remarkable. Since 1977, after emergency, 70% of the times the serving government has lost the elections and the opposition has come into power. So that's also something very, very remarkable. In a way, anti-incumbency, opposition to the government, opposition to the serving government, anti-incumbency has been a buzzword of our electoral democracy. Now, why does it happen? Why do people always vote against the serving government? This is an important question. This, on the one hand, this is indicative of the disenchanted times that we are living in. People are disenchanted. There is a spirit of disenchantment. There is a spirit of disenchantment with our politics, with our leaders. But it does mean that people seem to have acquired the power to change governments. They can change governments. They have a punitive power. People seem to, through their vote, people exercise punitive power, power to punish. They punish the rulers by bringing the opposition into power. And then they punish those rulers by bringing the other opposition into power. So they have the power to punish, change government. But the fact that power still rotates within a very small circle, it also means that the people do not seem to possess the power to create alternatives. So the strength of our procedural democracy is that people vote a government out, bring a new government in, people punish the government, punish the politicians, rulers, but they do not seem to have the power to create alternatives. So they seem to be alternating between A and B, A, B and C. Our democracy does not have the power to create alternatives. So that is a problem. So that is the achievement of our procedural democracy. That is also the limitation of our procedural democracy. If procedurally our democracy seems to be doing well, then substantive democracy, probably not so much. What is substantive democracy? Substantive democracy is all about a genuine empowerment of the people. Genuine empowerment of the people. Not of any one segment, not of any faction, but people as a whole. Genuine empowerment should ideally come. Does ideally come with two other ideas. Now, this is a complex point. I want you to pay some attention to it. Affluence and resource distribution. Please, those mathematics students, please draw a triangular in your mind. And there are three points in the triangular. Genuine empowerment, resource distribution, and affluence. Now, these three points in a triangular, they are in a dialogical relationship. They should be in a dialogical relationship with each other. Genuine empowerment should lead to a distribution of resources. Distribution of resources should lead to affluence, and affluence, wealth, then should lead to genuine empowerment of the people. The conditions will remain unsatisfactory till this triangle is complete. So genuine empowerment in itself is not enough. It becomes enough when it has a combination with resource distribution and affluence. Unless there is affluence, what is there to distribute? There are no resources to distribute. If the distribution does not happen, then the resources are concentrated into very few hands. So there should be resources, they should be distributed, and that will create a genuine empowerment of the people. So this triangle should become complete. As of now, we have an incomplete triangle. Democracy left to itself, if you leave democracy only to itself, then it does not have the capacity to create affluence. That unfortunately cannot happen. Democracy is a political idea. It cannot create affluence. In the classical theories of democracy, democracy was supposed to follow affluence. In the West, once there was industrialization, once wealth had been generated, then democracy came. So democracy followed affluence. It did not precede it. Democracy left to itself cannot create affluence. It can only create conditions, which is why you need the triangle of affluence, empowerment, and distribution. And one, they should be in a constant dialogue with each other. They should feed into each other. But till the triangle gets ready, till the triangle is complete, there is every likelihood that even an empowerment of the people can get pulled into either of the two extreme directions. If there is no affluence and distribution, if there is just an empowerment of the people, then what will happen? At one level, it will be elite manipulated. So some elite, some faction, some group will manipulate democracy, will appropriate democracy. So genuine empowerment will get appropriated by vested interests, by elites, or by some faction. At one end. So at one end, our democracy will be elite driven. At another end, it will go in the opposite direction and turn towards a mobocracy and become populist. Mobocracy means when 50 people or 100 people, they become a law unto themselves. That can also. So both these risks, manipulation by an elite or a complete mobocracy, democracy turning into a mobocracy, both these risks are there. If an empowerment of the people is not connected to these other two ends, resource distribution and affluence. Coming back again to partition, it is quite clear that the three running themes of the partition, our relationship with Pakistan, four wars, 65, 71, 47, an exacerbated minority problem, and three, Kashmir. All the three are issues that have affected the functioning of Indian democracy in ways that are sometimes obvious and sometimes not so obvious. Let me hint at two, and then I'm going to wind up in 5 minutes. It was basically two wars with Pakistan in 61 and 65 and 71, along with other worsening economic conditions that actually paved the way for the JP movement, about which some of you may not be familiar, and the emergency in 1975 for 18 months. Emergency was the only example in Indian history of independent India in those 70 years when democracy was formally withdrawn for 18 months and before it was restored. So some of it, the background actually goes back to the crisis of the 60s, the two wars with Pakistan. Wars are, they take their toll on the society, they extract resources and create a long-term resentment. The three wars with China in 62, 65 and 71. In one decade, India had three wars and they took their toll and created conditions for what happened in the 1970s. Secondly, in the other way in which the partition has affected the quality of our democracy is the majority-minority scenario. That too has created a dangerous political practice of competitive communalism, in which political parties appeal either to religion of majority or to religion of minority, and both majority and minority, they get consolidated. They become fixed blocks in politics. Our democracy, therefore, has become a real victim of this competitive communalism. This too is a legacy of the partition. So partition and all that happened, it has cast its spell on the nature, quality and destiny of our democracy. This is a large theme and obviously needs to be explored further. To sum up then, I would now like to wind up. I would like to say only two things by way of a summary. One, Indian democracy, it can be said, is doing well and doing badly at the same time. In the 70 years, the stock total overall performance charge sheet record of Indian democracy is that it's doing well and badly at the same time. It is doing badly because the democratic institutions are in danger all over. There is a threat. There is a threat of either elite manipulation or of mobocracy or of appropriation. So there is our democratic institutions are vulnerable. They can collapse or they can be overtaken. So it is doing badly. But it is also doing well because nobody is really opposed. We have not had an anti-democratic movement since 1947. Nobody is opposed to democracy. Democracy has become a very sacred idea. We all want it, however imperfect it is. Those who are unhappy with democracy, they also want to appropriate it rather than being consciously opposed to it. So even if democracy is violated in practice, it is not repudiated in principle. So the principle of democracy is constantly upheld. People accuse each other of being less democratic. They claim greater democracy for themselves. So in that sense, the sacred idea is there. Nobody is against the idea of democracy. The second thing that I would like to say is related to partition, that the partition, India's partition in 1947, it did cast its shadow on the life trajectory of Indian democracy in a whole range of ways. I hinted at some, but there are, if one were to work further, I think we can discern a whole range of other ways in which Indian democracy has grown in the shadows of the partition of India in 1947. I will stop here. Thank you very much for listening to me.